The only thing necessary for evil to succeed is for good men to do nothing. It's important that people wake up to what is going on. It's time that we read the Constitution. It is error that needs the support of government. Truth can stand alone. That was given to us by Thomas Jefferson. Thank you for tuning in. My name is Daniel Hapney. This is The Real Story. Tonight we have Hal Shurtleff with us. Hal, welcome once again to The Real Story.
Glad to be back on. I guess you must like me around, having me around, because this is like the third or fourth time I've been on your show.
It's a good thing. You know, we try to give...
Your ratings go way up when I'm on, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. From 10 to 11, right?
I got at least 13.
I must have a relative in town or something I don't know about.
Tonight we wanted to do a little bit of book review stuff. So you were mentioning you brought The Shadows of Power.
Well, I brought a little batch of books, and I think that videos are great. You know, YouTube is a great way to get information, and DVDs are a great way, but to me there's nothing like the written word. And I think that I think a good DVD, I mean, if I was to get a copy of this show, for example, you know, I'd watch it. I might be motivated to go out and get some of these books so that they were talking about, right?
Exactly.
Because nothing, in my opinion, nothing beats the written word. You know, there's a lot of other great mediums, but the written word is the most important word, and probably the most influential in the history of mankind.
You know. Happy Gutenberg. I tend to agree with you there.
And there's a lot of books. I could probably spend hours upon hours upon hours, but a lot of folks were just so misinformed out there. We're just inundated with information, some of it good, some of it bad, some of it we don't know how to analyze it. And when I give presentations as a field rep for the John Birch Society, I usually begin by saying, folks, if you leave here with nothing else, leave here with a copy of this book, Shadows of Power. And in fact, the gentleman who wrote the book is speaking tonight up in the North Shore, which I would have been up there if I weren't here.
Thank you for coming.
But he can be in two places at once, because I'm down here pushing. It's not so much I'm pushing a book, but I'm promoting what's between the pages. This book, Shadows of Power, was written by a man named James Perloff, who was a Greater Boston, born and raised in Greater Boston. And he, in his own words, was a 60s leftist, 60s hippie type.
Mm-hmm.
Banned the bomb, you know, down with the establishment, burn, baby, burn. He was educated at some local colleges in Maine, mm-hmm. and what have you. And he used to write for the Maine, Colby College in Maine, he used to write for their paper. And he was very critical of the establishment, but at some point in his life, he was also a hardcore atheist, too,
mm-hmm.
Which sort of goes hand-in-hand.
And back then, I could understand it. There were a lot of things going on.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. He did ask a few questions, though, about the establishment. He realized that he discovered that somehow the establishment was funding the groups that he was in sympathy. You know, groups like the Black Panthers and groups like the Students for Democratic Society and other type of organizations, some of them no longer around. And he then posed some questions, which any intellectually honest person would do. Why are they giving us this money? And so then, of course,
you ask
a question, you raise answers. Well, they're giving us this money. It could be, one, that they're afraid of us and they're trying to buy our favor. Maybe we won't kill you off all at once if we take over or something. Question two, they want to influence us. Answer two.
Exactly.
Answer three is that they control us. They're the ones that created us.
That's very, very interesting, because it wouldn't be the first time in history.
And I think it was the Strawberry Statements, was one of these leftists whose name, I forgot. But he talked about the establishment dudes that would come in and we would take their money. You know, what are these guys doing this for, you know? And that was the first time. It was one of these documents that was made the rounds in certain circles of the far left. Why are these guys with the bow ties and the pinstripe suits coming and giving us money, you see? And folks remember the newspaper, the Boston Phoenix.
Yes.
When it first came out, it was the underground, Boston's underground paper. Well, today it is so establishment, it's ridiculous. But if you got a 19, I don't know when it first came out, in the mid-60s, we're all into advertisements. It wasn't Joe's marijuana shop or Joe's, there might have been a few of those. We used to call them head shops, you remember those days?
Yeah.
It was the big record companies, and the establishment-owned record companies that kept this paper going. The establishment they were supposed to be against. Well, the Boston Phoenix, and I'm just using this as an illustration, not trying to get too far.
No, but I see it all around me in other things.
The Boston Phoenix had an article last, it was January of 2009, this year, going after the Article 10 movement. Article 10 movement where people around the country and legislators around the country trying to get the 10th Amendment back where it should be. Basically says that the powers that Congress or the Constitution did not grant specifically to Congress or to the federal government or denied to the states are reserved to the states and to the people.
Check.
And that's a lot, by the way.
That's huge.
And
exactly.
you read this article, instead of saying, yes, man, you know, here's the Boston Phoenix, the established, anti-establishment, yeah, off the system, off Whitey, you know. No, they denounced this movement, and who do they bring as guest experts and interviewed? Lawrence Tribe, you know, the establishment figures.
Okay.
So actually, they ran my letter saying, yeah, here was this anti-establishment paper, you're trotting out the same old tired establishment people defending the status quo.
I see it all over. If you've ever heard of Aaron Russo, who did Freedom of Fascism, talks of how it was, you know, what you consider the establishment that started the women's movement. And it was the bankers who said, well, we haven't got them paying taxes. But if we get them in the work for you, we can get them too.
And the pornographers like that too.
Well, the other thing that I'm looking at is just the thought of controlled opposition. If you have so much power and control, wouldn't you like to control your opposition? And we see that all over with Republican Democrat, that you know, we believe, oh, one party's against the other, when really both parties are the same, doing the same thing.
What you hear on most talk radio today, it might be mainly conservative, but they have a neoconservative position, and all of the evils are blamed on the Democrats, and then the Democrats blame all the evils of the world on the Republicans, and that's as far as it goes.
Well, that's there to keep, this is old Roman stuff,
that's
right?
That's right.
Keep us divided.
Keep us divided.
They don't want us, people, you, the viewers, to be united in liberty. They don't want us to be united in, you know, the mindset of freedom, okay? Right. Let alone, you know, the personal property rights, you know, by keeping us in groups. Oh, I'm a dark-skinned group, I'm a white-skinned group.
Right.
Oh, I'm a blue state, I'm a red state. Oh, it's the tribal thing. It's to bring that tribe. That's how I see it. It's divide and conquer.
But anyway,
tribes.
Anyway, well, Jim Perloff, who's become a very good friend of mine, ended up going into, he looked at the source, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, where the money was coming from the big foundations, the Carnegie Foundation,
money.
The Rockefeller Foundation, the Mellon Foundation. And then he looked a little bit further and saw that these organizations were all tied to a group called the Council on Foreign Relations. So he spent about a year and a half researching the subject at the Boston Public Library, the main library, and he nailed them with their own words. This is the book. It's a history of the Council on Foreign Relations from its founding at the Majestic Hotel in Paris, France, right after World War I, 1919. Where not only the CFR, Council on Foreign Relations, was founded, but the Royal Institute of International Studies, so sort of a parent or a sister organization. And they had a purpose. It wasn't just to sit around, so we have a nice little funky club to go to when we're in Manhattan. You know, nothing else to do. We go to a nice book line study and sit around and smoke cigars. They had an agenda. And this agenda was laid out by the Carnegie Institute back in when it was first founded in 1910, 1911. They asked some questions. How do we control, how do we get into war? Or what vehicle other than war will dramatically change society to benefit us, benefit our agenda? And they said that there isn't any other vehicle. And how do we get into a war? Well, you have to control the newspapers. You've got to control Congress. You've got to control the president, the office of the president. And you have to control the military. You have to have, so they were able to form this organization. And this wasn't formed by lower middle class people.
Close. I'm with
this
you.
Was the elite.
Well, these were these elites. At the same time, Carnegie around 1910 was funding what? Cold Springs Harbor with Harriman's, the tycoon's wife, the railroad tycoons. And these people with their eugenics program that, once again, Hitler picked up on.
That's right.
But these, you know, so this is nothing new for them, for the elitists, these global elitists, to do this, to think this way, because they, once you get up to that position of power, you want to stay there.
You want to stay there.
And whatever you can do to keep the people down,
you will do it. And that's where the income tax came in, by the way. The big foundations were formed before the income tax. And the vast amounts of profits that were made by these so-called monopoly capitalists. Capitalism is, free market capitalism is a good thing. Monopoly capitalism is what we see with these folks is bad. And so because the person on the left thinks capitalism is all monopoly capitalism and it's automatically evil, and they don't have the proper concept. So anyway, the John Birch Society published this book in 1988. And as an activist organization, we're not just sit here, here's a nice book to read, and you know, if you want to buy it, fine. No, but we got copies of this book to every single state legislator in the country, all 50 states. And of course, some legislators get stuff all the time. I'm sure some of them ended up in the wastebasket. Some of them read it and thought, oh, you know, this is kind of... We also sent copies to members of the CFR, and that was very interesting, mm-hmm. some of the responses we got.